Meet Arthur. Arthur is really good at math, and he always has been. In fact, he planned on going to college to study math, but recently, life didn't pan out the way he expected it to, and so he's not quite where he thought he would be by now. Sounds like most of us. What is more probable? One, that Arthur is a lifeguard at the local beach, or two, that Arthur is a math tutor at a local school and a lifeguard in his free time? The correct answer here is 1, that Arthur is a lifeguard at the local beach and only that. Now don't worry if you got it wrong, the majority of people do, even people with years of experience in statistics. If you chose 2, the error you made is known as a conjunction fallacy. You see, even without knowing anything else about Arthur beyond what the problem tells us, we can be certain that 2 is less probable than 1. Why? Because it's more specific, meaning it involves the probability of Arthur being a lifeguard and the probability of Arthur being a math tutor in conjunction. You may find it easier to visualize using a Venn diagram like this one. Questions like this one were developed in the 1980s to test cognitive biases, among other things. Why is this important for this video, though? Because it offers a general statistical insight that is relevant everywhere else as well, even, as you will see, in the deepest trenches of reality. The insight is simply that more specificity is less likely. The scenario of Arthur being a lifeguard and a math tutor may seem more likely, given how I've intentionally described Arthur to be mathematically inclined. But no matter how mathy he might sound, option 2 is the more specific scenario of the set, meaning more things have to go a certain way for it to occur, and it's therefore less likely. For a more drastic example, which is more likely? Getting struck by lightning, or getting struck by lightning and getting hit by a car in the same day. Now, onto the deepest trenches of reality. Have you ever wondered why most of the processes that go on in our lives are so seemingly irreversible? Why do they tend to go one way and not the other? Why is it that sugar can be stirred into a cup, but when you move your spoon the other way, it never unstirs itself? Why is it so that the sock drawer always needs to be organized by someone and never does so on its own accord? Why is it that a cup of cold water doesn't suddenly start boiling? These questions might seem unwarranted, and even dumb. We have so much intuition for these things that it almost seems unnecessary to ask these questions to begin with. But the reason why they need to be asked is because there's actually nothing in physics, no law or theory, that is against these processes reversing themselves. Laws that are obeyed when a cup of warm water cools down are obeyed just as well as when it heats up. So there must be something, something else that's tipping the balance almost. Something that almost wants gases to disperse through a room. Something that wants that cup to go cold. That thing is known as entropy, and it may have more to do with probability than with physics or chemistry. But first, let's try and understand what entropy means. You can understand a lot about a concept just by thinking about how it was named. The term entropy was coined in 1865 by Rudolf Clausius, who used it to define the second law of thermodynamics. However, it's much better if we try to understand the term using classical languages. The Greek word for entropy doesn't necessarily refer to disorder like you might expect. Rather, it talks about isotropic turning, meaning same no matter how you turn it. It's talking about the number of ways you can change something, or transform something, and still have it look the same. If you want to think of it in simpler ways, think of a disorganized desk. There are some ways in which you could organize a desk, and you can directly specify them, since an organized desk refers to a particular arrangement of things in a particular way. When it comes to a disorganized desk, there's really no rule that needs to be followed. A desk can be disorganized in so many more ways. Of course, a stash of papers on the left might look different than a stash of papers on the right, but in the grand scheme of things, it's simply disordered. Especially when that's the only distinction you're drawing, one between order and disorder. Now, these things might seem simple enough, but there are certain missing links we need to address before we jump from an analogy like that to reality. First, let me remind you of what we just talked about at the start of the video, that more specificity is less likely. If we use that in the desk analogy, it means that since an organized desk is a comparatively more specific arrangement, it is less likely than a disorganized desk to occur just by random chance. I'm sure you have some intuition for this. If you organize your desk at the start of the week, unless you do something to maintain that order, it's probably not going to stay very ordered as the week goes on. Another missing link is the fact that in reality, things aren't super distinguishable. Particles at the atomic level are much harder to tell apart than the things on your desk. Even if certain disorganized versions of your desk might look different to you, you can rest assured that that won't be the case when you're looking at a million particles that all look the same. But arguably the biggest link that makes entropy a hard concept to digest is the scale of things. You and I really have no clue, and I mean it when I say it, no clue as to the real size and number of things. Of course, you've heard things about there being more stars than grains of sand and whatnot, but you really don't know how big it is. The term unfathomable gets thrown around quite a lot, but rarely is its use as fitting as it is now. Reality is unfathomably complicated. Even if you measure complexity just by the number of particles, you and I will fail to internalize the sheer size of things no matter how much we try. But I'm gonna go ahead and try anyways. Let's look at a box with two compartments and a few balls in them. Let's start nice and easy. So we have two identical balls. We allow the balls to move freely in between the two compartments. At any given point in time, where could the balls be? Well, they could all be in the left compartment, that's scenario number one. Or one ball could be in the left and the other could be in the right. That accounts for two scenarios actually. Since there's two identical balls, if we were able to swap them in this arrangement, we wouldn't be able to tell them apart. Or they could all be in the right compartment, the fourth and final scenario. All of these situations are equally likely. Now, what is the probability of finding both balls in the left compartment? Only one out of the four possible scenarios meets our requirement, so it's going to be 1 out of 4, or 25%. Now, let's bump it up a bit. Instead of having just two identical balls, let's have four. Now, since there's more balls to move around, the number of ways they can be arranged also goes up. This can be represented by 2 to the power of the number of balls. In this case, 2 to the power of 4 is 16. Subsequently, our luck needs to be that much better to have all the balls spontaneously place themselves in the left compartment. And sure enough, the probability of having all 4 balls in the left compartment is now down to 1 in 16. Let's keep going. What happens when we have 5 balls? The probability goes down to 1 in 32. What happens with 16 balls? The probability goes down to 1 in 65,536. Notice how quickly the numbers jump up. Let's jump ahead a bit. What happens with 128 balls, which is still a pretty good number, we can still kind of visualize that. The probability is now down to a staggering 1 in whatever this number is. Now let's take a step back to put things in perspective. We rarely have these well-defined compartments in reality. Things move around wherever they want to, and so the number of ways in which they can arrange themselves, even with 2 balls, is, and I'll say it again, unfathomably large. But that's still with just 2 balls. Remember earlier in the video I said it would be hard for you to distinguish between particles when you're looking at a million of them at once? Even a million particles is such a gross underestimation of reality, it's not even a contest. Something as little as 20 milliliters of water, basically the last sip of water in a bottle, has not a million particles, not 10 million, not even a quadrillion particles. It has over 10 sextillion, or 10 to the 23 particles. I'll spare you the math on this one, but let this be the takeaway. Things get really complicated really fast. To connect the dots with our other takeaway, in reality, an ordered arrangement of particles, such as gas that is not dispersed, or sugar that has not been mixed, also is significantly more specific when compared to other disorderly arrangements, like the desk example. That specificity makes it so much less likely. There's that many more particles to arrange, there's that much more luck needed for an orderly arrangement to exist. When you put all of that together, it starts making sense why things tend towards disorder. It's not so much that the laws of physics are biased towards one arrangement or another, rather, disordered arrangements are so overwhelmingly more likely than ordered arrangements, that if you let nature do its thing, things will always become more and more disordered. It's remarkable that, at the core of it all, it's not a law of physics or chemistry, but rather one of probability. Interestingly though, this can lead to the curious insight that it is indeed possible for a cup of water to spontaneously go from cold to hot. If the trend towards disorder is indeed independent of the laws of physics, there should be no problem with that happening. And in reality, there really isn't. Why don't we see it then? Well, the scale of things comes into play again. going back to the ball compartment example, even if, say, we reduce the number of balls back to 1,000, and say that the balls change to a different arrangement a million times a second, we would still have to wait 300 quadronanigantillion years to see them all in the left compartment. That's many more orders of magnitude than the age of the universe, all for something as simple as 1,000 balls being put into a box. It's fair to say that it wouldn't be very wise to wait for that to happen. But what if you did? What if you saw out all of the arrangements of everything in the universe? Well, that brings us to the power of entropy in giving us an insight into the end of existence. You see, energy that we can use often needs to be in a particular form, in an ordered form. You can think of it in terms of food. Foods are just molecules, and everything has molecules. But you just can't eat everything. You can only eat things in which those molecules are arranged in very particular ways. In any other disordered arrangement, energy simply isn't very useful. And across the universe, energy is constantly transitioning from an ordered to a disordered form, causing a loss of useful energy. This sort of a progression also implies that at the start of the universe, energy was probably very ordered. But what must have got it there? Was it just a fortuitous ordering of particles? And what happens if this process keeps going on? Well, the most likely outcome is what is known as the heat death of the universe. As the arrow of time pushes us forward, each day the universe inches closer to maximum entropy, a state of no thermodynamic free energy. It doesn't necessarily mean that the universe will be hot or that it'll be cold. It just means that once everything has equalized to disorder, there will be no temperature difference to motivate a thermodynamic process to occur. Nothing changes. Nothing happens. Time ceases to have any meaning. This gradual process is inevitable, but it is nonetheless hard to see. The universe is hardly distinguishable from one day to the next, so to imagine that it might all one day simply cease to exist is a bit hard to wrap your head around. But that's not to say that we're so oblivious to the regularity of decay. It's all around us. Fading memories, aging, death, and the ultimate impermanence of our existence repeatedly remind us of decay. But if it's all so inevitable, what's really the point of it all? Why even bother? In his book Enlightenment Now, Steven Pinker says, "The second law of thermodynamics defines the ultimate purpose of life, mind, and human striving, to deploy energy and information to fight back the tide of entropy, and carve out refuges of beneficial order. An underappreciation of the inherent tendency towards disorder, and a failure to appreciate the precious niches of order we carve out, are a major source of human folly." Maybe it really is just that. Small moments of apparent order against an inescapable reality of decay. But eventually, the lights have to go out one last time. The heat death of the universe is still a theory. It's a theory in a sense that we would have to cycle through all the different ways in which things can arrange themselves. And while the sheer numbers and timescales involved are too large for a human lifetime, that's not the case for the universe. The universe has time, and in a sense, is time. What is to say that in doing so, in going through all the different combinations, we won't stumble upon an orderly arrangement again? Sure, it might take many quadronanigantillion years for something like that to happen, but it can happen. The possibility is vanishingly small, but it remains non-zero. And when that does happen, the lights just might turn back on. And for all we know, we might just end up back at square one. This video was sponsored by Brilliant, one of the best places to learn everything math, science, and computer science related. Entropy is unavoidable. It is baked into the foundation of our existence, and in a sense, it is our existence. Now maybe you're just like me. You could be interested in learning more about cryptocurrency, or maybe you want to brush up on the basics of computer science, or maybe you just want to learn more about the everyday physics that govern our world. So what do you do? You're already watching educational videos on YouTube, and that's a good start. But in order to really learn something, you're pretty much forced to do it. Brilliant is built off of this very principle. You learn best while doing and solving things in real time. It's the best way to truly internalize the information you receive. Brilliant has some of the most interesting and complex topics in the world of STEM, and they do an amazing job of explaining it in ways that will stick. There are no final exams, there's no stress. If you get stuck or make mistakes, there's literally no downside. They give you concise explanations to help you learn at your own pace. Whether you're a college graduate or just someone interested in learning things, I really would suggest you check out Brilliant. Join me and a community of 8 million others by clicking the link in the description down below and visiting brilliant.org/aperture. If you visit, not only can you sign up for free, but you'll get 20% off a premium subscription that will unlock every single course Brilliant has to offer.